particular subject. So we will go ahead. So the discussion is on haloalkenes and haloarenes. So this is the topic what we are going to see now. So here we go. So the thing, what is the halo? So to come with the word, the halo refers to halogen. Halo refers to halogen. What is halogen? The halogen refers to the atoms of the seventh group elements. Okay, seventh group elements, the atoms which belong to seventh group elements, they are called halogens. We know that very well. So what are the seventh group elements? Fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine. So these are the things. They are all diatomic molecules. You know that very well. And now, what are these haloalkenes? First, we'll see what are haloalkenes. Haloalkenes. What are these haloalkenes? If at all, the carbon atom is connected to one of these things. So we'll write it as X. Okay. Rest of all other bonds are different. Rest of carbon can form four bonds. The idea is that carbon maximum, it can form four bonds. Okay. Carbon maximum, it can form four bonds. So the funda is that what is X here? X has to be either fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine. Astine we will not consider because it is radioactive. All these four are the things which we consider for the haloalkenes. So what is an alkene? First of all, alkene are the compounds or the formulas CnH2n plus 2. Haloalkene is the one when the hydrogen, for example, we'll consider the ethane. This is our ethane, right? So when you take ethane and you remove one hydrogen and put one of the thing here, anything. So that anything is represented by X. So you substitute the hydrogen with some X, then we will call it as a haloalkene. I hope I'm clear with this. Is this okay? Now first part, this is the starting part of haloalkenes. Now what are haloarenes? We'll do that. What are haloarenes? What are haloarenes? See, arene means if you have a kind of benzene ring, that means a rings of aromaticity. So aromatic rings, they, you know that they have 4n plus 2 pi electrons. Those things are called aromatic in nature. So when the haloarene means in the benzene ring, you have at every position, you have hydrogens. You know that very well. Now, if at all I substitute one of the hydrogen with X, then what I get is over the benzene ring, I will get X on the top, right? So such things, they are called haloarenes. I hope I'm clear with what are haloalkenes and what are
Over that,
you get an X group. So you have fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine. If any one of the things sits over the benzene ring, that means instead of hydrogen, this hydrogen is replaced by the X. Then we'll call it as haloarene. Clear? Arene means, always remember, arene means a benzene ring. For your level, arene means benzene ring, or it can be of this kind of systems are also called arenes. Means this is naphthalene. Okay, this is what is naphthalene. So if you have this kind of thing, means three benzene rings are fused together, such a thing is called anthracene. Okay, such a thing is called anthracene. Sir. So you can have another thing called phenanthrene. All these things are called aromatic rings. Like this, if the connectivities are there, this is the situation of phenanthrene. So like this, this is naphthalene, this is anthracene, this is called phenanthrene. All these things together, you can have any kind of aromatic ring. So such things over which one of the hydrogen is substituted by X group. What is X? We call it, the X is nothing but a halogen. The X is nothing but a halogen. If such a group substitution you are seeing, they are called haloarenes or haloalkanes. Haloalkanes, when you will get, when you have an alkane in which the hydrogen is substituted by the X group. So such a situation are called haloalkanes or haloarenes. This is the topic what we are going to discuss. Now let us see the one of the basis, on the basis of number of halogen atoms, we will classify the substituents. So the one is called, the first one is called monohaloalkanes. What are monohaloalkanes? Suppose I consider like CH3X, that is only one hydrogen is substituted by X. They are called monohaloalkanes. So like this, you can have dihaloalkanes also. Dihaloalkanes. The dihaloalkanes, you have like, you can have like this. The ethane in which two hydrogens are substituted by X. X can be in any other thing. Chlorine, bromine, iodine, okay, fluorine. One of the things. If it is substituted, X can be anything which is giving a substituent over here. Then you will call it as dihaloalkane. You can have trihaloalkane also. Trihaloalkanes means in the carbon chain, if X is substituted, three substitutions are there, then you would tell that it's a trihaloalkane. So this kind of situation you will call as trihaloalkane. So I hope I am clear with the warning. Yeah, here CH only will come because the bonds have to be satisfied. Maximum carbon will form four bonds. That's how you had to put the things. Okay. And now you have the haloarenes can be like, you can have monohaloarene. Monohaloarene means only one X. And you can have dihaloarene. That means you can have two substitutions. So that is a dihaloarene. This is a monohaloarene. So this is a dihaloarene. So this is the kind of substitution. You can have trihaloarene also, but it's like when you have a three substituents. Okay, when you have three substitutions, multiple substitutions you are having, then it's a trihaloarene. So this is how we can differentiate. The next part is the nature of carbon X bond. This is another important thing what we have to understand. Now, what is the nature of the CX bond? So one thing you have to understand that X, they are fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine. These elements are actually up to here I would say easily that these are more electronegative compared to carbon. First of all, this is the first point what you have to know. These are more electronegative compared to carbon. They tend to pull bonded electrons of CX bond, especially the first three things, fluorine, chlorine, bromine, especially the first three. Iodine is little bit less, but I can say exactly that first three elements, they have this strong property. They tend to pull the bonded electrons of the CX bond, okay, towards them. They tend to pull the bonded electrons towards them, and they tend to gain a little bit of negative charge. So this is the stuff what you have to learn. Okay, these are more electronegative compared to carbon. These are more electronegative compared to that of carbon. First point, they tend to pull the bonded electrons of CH bond. What is this bonded electrons of CH bond? I'll explain this. Now, if you have any doubt, you please let me know. This is how the bond electrons will be. See, the carbon X bond is a sigma bond. Okay, I hope you know what is sigma bond. So the carbon electron, this bond, whatever is there, this X is there. No, it will tend to attract these electrons towards it because they are like more electronegative in nature compared to carbon. So the reason these electrons will be pulled towards X. So what happens? The electrons come closer to X. So what happens now? This is the first position. Initially, you can assume the electrons are moving closer to X. Okay, and the X will gain negative charge, and the carbon will be positive charge. Got it? Is it clear? Hello.
Yes, sir.
Okay, good.
Yes, sir.
Now because of this, the X will always gain negative charge, and the carbon will always gain positive charge. Because of that, a dipole is created. A dipole is created within the molecule. So, got it? No. So the carbon always becomes a positive center, and the X becomes a negative center. I hope I am clear with this. This property, whatever I have shown, I'll tell you what is this property is called. This property is called negative I effect. What is the minus I effect? The permanent displacement. Permanent displacement of electron pair bonded. Permanent displacement of bonded electron pair towards the highly electronegative atom is called minus I effect. So, in a covalent bond, first of all, the permanent displacement of the bonded electron pair towards the highly electronegative atom is called minus I effect. Remember this. So, it is a permanent effect. the effect will last long until the molecule is there. So this is another point. The effect lasts long. The effect lasts long until the bonds are intact. So it's like a permanent damage to the molecule. So until that bond is there, until the time the bond is there, this effect is always there. So that is the fundamental idea what you have to put it in mind. So in a covalent bond, the permanent displacement of the bonded electron pair towards a highly electronegative atom is called minus I effect. So I hope I am clear what it is. Okay. So this is the one which you have to keep in mind. Now, there are the kind of alkyl halides. There are different kinds of alkyl halides. Something called primary alkyl halides. So before that, to understand this, we need to understand one thing. Primary carbon, secondary carbon, and tertiary carbon. These are the things what we have to understand. What is a primary carbon? What is a secondary carbon? What is a tertiary carbon? Primary carbon, a carbon connected to one carbon or no carbon. So that is called a primary carbon. Suppose, for example, I will tell you. So this is what is a primary carbon, CH3X. Now, in this one, the carbon is a primary carbon. If X is attached to primary carbon, so here it's a fibrate. If X attached to primary carbon, it is primary alkyl halide. Is this clear, Amma? Now, what is secondary carbon? I hope it is clear with you. If you have any confusion, please let me know. Another example is CH3. Here, this carbon is also primary carbon. Okay. Suppose I give you like this, a wedge structure, something like CH3, CH2, CH3. Here, this carbon is a primary, this carbon is a primary, but this is secondary. That we are coming into now. Secondary carbon, a carbon connected to two carbons. That is a secondary carbon. I hope I am clear with this. What is secondary carbon? Suppose you have CH3, CH2, CH3. This is a primary carbon, because this is connected to only one carbon. This is secondary carbon because this carbon is connected to two carbons. So this is secondary. And again, this is primary because this is connected to only one carbon. Clear? Now, the thing is that if the X is connected to only the secondary carbon, it is called secondary alkyl halide. So secondary alkyl halide. I hope I'm clear. If you have any confusion, please let me know. This is very, very important. This plays a large role. So any confusion, please let me know.
Understood.
Now, can you tell me what would be the tertiary carbon mean? Can you guess
that? Carbon is connected to the three carbons.
A carbon connected to three carbons is known as tertiary carbon. if x is connected to that, if x is connected to the tertiary carbon, then it is tertiary carbon, tertiary alkyl halide. So tertiary alkyl halide means what? If x is connected to the tertiary carbon, then it is tertiary alkyl halide. So you have the example is, the best example what we give is tertiary butyl chloride. So here this carbon is the tertiary carbon. If x is connected to the tertiary carbon, then it, you will say that it is tertiary alkyl halide. I hope I am clear with this. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. We go ahead. Now after this, we have vinyl halide. Vinyl halide. What is a vinyl halide? Suppose you have, you know, what is this? This is ethylene. Okay, this is ethylene molecule. In the ethylene molecule, it looks like this actually. So I draw like this. This is my ethylene molecule. Now, in this ethylene molecule, if I replace this hydrogen with something like X, so I am replacing the circled hydrogen with some X. Such a thing is called this kind of molecule is called vinyl halide. Vinyl halide. So what we are doing, it is like the X is connected to an sp2 carbon directly. X. So here the hybridization of carbon is sp2, right? Because when you see a double bond, that's sp2 hybridization. X connected to an sp2 carbon. Okay, sp2 carbon having sp2 hybridization. sp2 carbon, we'll call sp2 carbon. Then you would say that it is vinyl, or the carbon should have a double bond on the other side. So you can say that X connected to carbon which is involved in a double bond. Involved in a double bond. Such a situation is called vinyl. Such a molecule is called vinyl molecule. We'll end up with a vinyl system. Such a system is called a vinyl system, or the molecule is called a vinyl molecule. So this is called vinyl chloride. We all know that when you polymerize this, what we get is PVC plastic. What is that? Polyvinyl chloride. If you take vinyl chloride and polymerize that, what you get is polyvinyl chloride. So anyway, I think you will read this one also in the polymers. So if it is not omitted for you in this year.
Omitted.
Polymers. Yes, okay. Then actually this will come in polymers. So the polyvinyl chloride is the polymer of vinyl chloride. Okay, ma. So these are called vinyl systems. This is the vinyl. Next one is allyl. Allyl system. What is an allyl system? So the situation here is like you have a double bond. After that, there is one carbon. Now here at this position, you have a chlorine. This is called allyl chloride. So what is this situation? How to define? When you jump from this carbon, this is an sp3 carbon. You have, this is sp3 carbon. And now when you jump just one carbon from here, the second carbon from this one will be having a double bond. This will be an sp2 carbon. This will be an sp3 carbon. So this second carbon, when you see this kind of situation, that is called allyl. Simple. So here, this is called vinyl. This is called allyl. Okay, clear. I hope I'm clear with this one.
Yes, sir.
Next one is that you have benzylic halides. Benzylic halides. What are these benzylic halides? Suppose you have, this is the benzene ring. On the benzene ring, if you have this kind of group, these is the CH2X. On the benzene, if you have CH2X, they are called benzylic halides. So as I told, these are called benzylic halides. So you can have more substituents also on this kind. So here you can have this kind of substitutions also. So such a things are called benzylic halides. So this is how we can do.
Okay, sir.
Next one, we are going ahead. Now they are containing. So there are certain systems like the X can be connected to a carbon which is having sp hybridization also. This is also possible, but I don't think we'll study much of this kind. We'll see. So the next one is that we have. So the next part is actually isomerism. Isomerism we'll see later. The nature of the CX bond, we have done it. Now we will straight away get into the reactions. Later we will read about the isomerism and the nomenclature part. First, what we do is we will go through the reactions. While doing the reactions, wherever the nomenclature comes, that I will explain how we have done the nomenclature.
Okay, sir.
Now, for the first one is methods of preparation of haloalkanes and haloarenes. Methods of preparation of haloalkanes and haloarenes. So methods of preparation of haloalkanes and haloarenes. So this is what we have to do. So the first one is we will go ahead first with the preparation of haloalkanes. So the first one is what we deal is that we'll go ahead with the preparation of haloalkanes. The first one out of this is from alcohols. So first of all, what are alcohols? When the carbon is connected to OH group, especially carbon connected to OH group, and here they are a different other groups are connected to carbon. Okay, when the carbon is connected to OH group, such things are called alcohols. Okay, these are called alcohols. Please make a note if you wish. Now onwards, that the subject will get intensified from here onwards. You have to be very, very careful. If you don't understand anything, please let me know. And here, from this point onwards, the subject gets complicated little bit for the beginners. Actually, for the beginners, this is really complicated. But generally, those who are little bit experienced, it will be really okay. But for the beginners, it will be little bit complicated. You have to be careful about this. Okay. Okay, ma. So you can make a note. If you have any doubt, you can tell me. So I'm clearing this.
Yes, sir. Okay.
So the first one is the preparation from alcohols. From alcohols, how do we prepare the alkyl halides from alcohols? What do we do? It is the most convenient method for the preparation of haloalkanes in the laboratory. So what we do is, we will take ROH. This is a laboratory method of preparation. In this method, the hydroxyl group of alcohol is replaced by halogen. In the reaction with the concentrated halogen acids, phosphorus halides or thionyl chloride. Okay, different reagents can be used to get the haloalkanes of alcohols are described below as per your textbook. I'm just reading. So here the next part is haloalkanes by the treatment. What you do is you treat this with HX. What is HX? HX means it can be like HCl, HBr, or HN. One of these three things you can use. If you want chloroalkane, you can use HCl. You want a bromo one, you want iodine, you will use HA. Like this, one can use. So what we get, the water is removed out of the reaction and the OH is substituted with X. So it will be like RX, okay? So how to do this? So there is a technique to remember this. How to use this technique? Now ROH, you write, you put HX like this, and now you remove water and join these two. So you get RX. I hope I am clear. It's as simple as that. So the water will go off. So actually we write a mechanism. Water will go off. We write a mechanism. I'll tell you how to deal with the mechanism of this thing.
No. Sir, mechanism, they will ask.
They will ask the mechanism question also. I'll tell you how to do that. First, please make a note. I will tell you. Don't worry.
Noted, sir.
Okay. Now, another point what you have to remember is the rate of reaction, the rate of reaction depends upon both alcohol as well as the halogen acid. Okay, so the rate of the reaction depends upon both halogen acid. Now note it, this one.
Okay, sir. Yes, sir.
The next one, next important point here. The reaction of, this is very, very important point. The reaction of primary and secondary alcohols. Reaction of primary and secondary alcohols with halogen acids. With halogen acids. With halogen acids require the presence of a catalyst that is zinc chloride. That is the catalyst what we use. Require a presence of a catalyst for zinc chloride, which acts as which acts as Lewis acid. The zinc chloride, it acts as a Lewis acid, okay, and helps the cleavage of and helps the cleavage of the carbon oxygen bond. It helps the cleavage of carbon oxygen bond. Okay. And the process is called Groot's process. Groot's process. This process is called Groot's process. This process, what we are discussing, is called Groot's process. Okay, I'll write what is that. So in that, what we do is CH3CH2OH, it is treated with ZnCl2 and HCl. Okay, ma. So ZnCl2 acts as a Lewis acid, so it forms CH3CH2Cl at the end. What is Lewis acid? Lewis acid is something. Lewis acids, they accept electron pairs. So what is a Lewis acid? Lewis acid is the one which will accept the electron pair. Lewis acids are the one which accept the electron pair. What are Lewis bases? When I say Lewis base are like ligands, what we had in the coordination chemistry. So Lewis bases are the one, they donate electron pair. They donate electron pair. If I say Lewis base, they can donate the electron pair. Lewis acids are the one, they can accept the electron pair. For example, here we have zinc chloride is a Lewis acid, and there are other things like boron trifluoride. Okay, these are all can act as Lewis acid. Of course, we have AlCl3, that can also act as a Lewis acid. For the Lewis base kind of things, you have NH3, all these things like NH3, like this, so many things will come. So these are the things which are categorized as Lewis bases. They can donate, they have the ability to donate the electron pair. I hope I'm clear with this one.
Okay, sir.
So now here the byproduct will be water. Okay, byproduct is water here. So let's see another thing here. So you have CH3. You have, this is connected to OH, right? This is what, this is tertiary butyl alcohol. Okay, tertiary butyl alcohol. Okay, this what we do is tertiary butyl alcohol, we can do directly, we don't have to worry about zinc chloride. So tertiary butyl alcohol, when you take HCl, you can get this directly, there is no problem. I'll tell you why, we will understand from SN1 SN2 reactions. Okay, so here you can get this directly. So plus H2O. So if you have a secondary alcohol, like this is the situation of what we have is, this is called isopropyl alcohol. What is isopropyl? You may get this doubt. See, this is three carbon chain is there, that is called propyl. Okay, and now you put the hydrogens like this, Now you see what I will do. If this hydrogen, that means the hydrogen connected to primary carbon, is substituted with OH, then I will say it is primary alcohol. This is also called N-propyl alcohol. This is N-propyl, which is normal. N refers to normal. Okay, N-propyl alcohol. So this naming is little bit, you may have some confusions, but I will clarify this. Okay, this is called N-propyl alcohol. Suppose I have a situation of this kind. Okay, hello, ma'am. Yeah.
Can you repeat once?
I will repeat. No problem. You see this. This is what? What is this? This is propane, right? This is propane. Is this clear? First of all, first you see this. This is propane. Yes, now, in the propane, you go to any terminal carbon. This carbon is primary carbon. This carbon is also a primary carbon, right? And this is my secondary carbon. This is my secondary carbon. Now you are clear about this. Primary, and this is secondary carbon. Now what I will do is, suppose this hydrogen is replaced by OH group. I will add OH group, okay, here. Then it is called N-propyl alcohol. N-propyl alcohol. N-propyl alcohol means it is a primary alcohol. Okay. Why it is primary alcohol? Because OH is connected to the primary carbon. So it is primary alcohol. OH is connected to the primary carbon. Hence it is primary alcohol. It is N-propyl alcohol. N-propyl alcohol means primary alcohol. Got it? Normal propyl. N means normal. N refers to normal propyl. Clear?
Yes, sir.
Now, here, what if I substitute here at the secondary carbon? So that is becoming secondary propyl alcohol, right? This is secondary propyl alcohol. This secondary propyl alcohol is called isopropyl alcohol. Secondary propyl alcohol, that is also secondary alcohol. Okay, this secondary alcohol is called isopropyl. Isopropyl meaning isopropyl alcohol. I will tell you another meaning. What is isopropyl? If the substitution is happening at the secondary carbon of propyl group, if the substitution is happening, I will write it. Isopropyl means you will not have any confusion. Isopropyl. What is isopropyl? If the substitution happens at the secondary carbon of the propyl chain. Propyl chain. What is a propyl chain? CCC. Three carbon chain. In the three carbon chain, if at all substitution is happening at the secondary carbon, it is called isopropyl. I hope I am clear now. So here, the substitution is happening here. That means the OH group substitution will come at the secondary carbon. Such a situation is called isopropyl. Such an alcohol is called isopropyl alcohol. Basically, if I have isopropyl alcohol means, isopropyl if I am talking means, I am talking about a secondary alcohol. Clear? I hope I am clear with this. Now, what we are doing with this? Now, I take this isopropyl alcohol. I take this isopropyl alcohol and treat it with HCl and ZnCl2. when you treat it with HCl and ZnCl2, what happens is you will get the chloride is being substituted instead of OH, and you get this. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay, that is what the reaction is. So the tertiary alcohols are very reactive. This one I already told you. So because as tertiary alcohols are very reactive towards HCl. In this context, we'll write towards HCl. Just shaking at room temperature with acid is sufficient. So we don't need to use, no need to use ZnCl2 for tertiary alcohols. So this point you keep in mind. Okay. Now, how to do this reaction? The next one. So here I will reproduce that what I have written. So this is tertiary butyl alcohol. This is tertiary butyl alcohol. It is treated with HCl at room temperature. When it is treated with HCl at room temperature, what I am going to get is CH3, 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 Cl. As I told you how the reaction goes, the water molecule is eliminated like this. You can think it like a trick, and the chlorine will get substituted here. Actual process is SN1 substitution, nucleophilic unimolecular reaction is the reaction mechanism this follows. Okay, so this plus water will be eliminated. So here the rate of reaction, so as I told you, depends on nature of alcohol and the acid. So what alcohol you are taking and what acid you are taking, it will depend. I hope I'm clear.
Yes, sir.
Now, how to prepare bromoalkanes? Bromoalkanes. So, how to do the bromoalkanes? How to make the bromoalkanes? Suppose you have, what we do is C2H5OH, that is ethyl alcohol. We will add HBr. So, you don't have to HBr. In the presence of, we have to use concentrated H2SO4. We have to use concentrated H2SO4. And HBr, one of the thing is about HBr, we don't need these things, but you get HBr 48% only. You will get azeotropic mixture. We'll get. And you got to heat this. And when you heat, you will get CH3, CH2, Br. So the thing is that you have to write all the conditions. Try to write all the conditions. So here what we got is ethyl bromide. Ethyl bromide. What we got is ethyl bromide. course BE should be small, ethyl bromide. And the other byproduct is water. And how to generate HBr? HBr generation is not easy. So the generation in situ, it is called INSITU. In situ generation of HBr. So sometimes we don't have to carry the HBr acid bottle. For that, what they do is they will add H2SO4 with either potassium bromide or sodium bromide, which will further generate HBr. So this is another method of generating HBr. So they generate HBr within the reaction vessel itself. So they will not pour the acid from outside. Such thing is called in situ preparation. So what they do? So here the in situ preparation mode is like this. So they will take C2H5OH, they will add KBr or NaBr. So in the exam you should not get confused if you are given KBr and NaBr and H2SO4. You have to remember that this KBr plus NaBr on treatment with H2SO4 is going to give us HBr in situ.
What is in situ?
Yeah, yeah. In situ means that's what I told you. INSIT, in situ means generating. I'll write that. Then you don't get confused. Generating the required reagent. Required reagent at that time or at that moment. Okay, I will explain this with an example, then you will understand this much better. So what is this in situ preparation? I'll tell you like an experiment. Let me complete this reaction. I'll tell you that like an experiment. C2H5Br plus H2O. Okay, this is the one. No, I'll explain this in situ preparation with an experiment. I will tell you that, describe an experiment so that you will understand this in situ preparation. Can I clear this?
One.
Oh yeah, you can note it. No problem.
Not
that, sir. Okay. So here we go. So what is this in situ preparation? I'll explain this. So consider a glass shaking bottle. Okay, you consider this. Now what my target is? My target is to prepare C2H5Br. Okay. Now the thing is, in the lab, for to make that, what is the reaction? You need a bottle of HBr, right? You need a bottle of HBr, right? Are you getting this? You need a bottle of HBr.
Yes,
and you need a bottle of C2H5OH to conduct this reaction. C2H5OH to conduct the reaction. Okay, right? These two are most essential for me. Now, the HBr is not present in your lab. Okay. HBr is not there with you. So let us delete that. But instead of that, you are provided with KBr and you are provided with a bottle of H2SO4. You are provided with KBr and H2SO4. and then C2H5OH. Now I ask you to prepare C2H5Br. Got it? Now what I will do, I can mix these two. I will mix these two chemicals in this beaker, pour these chemicals in this beaker, and you will instantly generate at that instant, you can generate HBr. Okay, got it? So H2SO4, when you make it react with KBr, it will produce HBr. Okay, HBr, and of course the other product is K2SO4. Okay, like this you will get the HBr. This HBr is utilized. Whatever the HBr now formed, it will react with what? The C2H5OH, what you pour into the beaker, plus C2H5OH. Now you have mixed these two thoroughly here within the beaker, then you got your product C2H5Br. Now I have prepared the HBr instantly by using some two different chemicals, that is KBr and H2SO4. Using these two different chemicals, I prepared what I want in the sense that I don't have the HBr. Okay, that is one thing. Incentive preparation is used. Sir, why you are doing like this? I can buy a bottle of HBr and do the same. Yeah, you can do that. But there is some problem with HBr. You cannot get 100% HBr. That is the problem. HBr is always mixed with water. So you can get maximum 48% HBr. So since only 48% HBr is available, which means that what is 48% HBr? I'll tell you. Suppose.
Why only 100% HBr is not available?
I will tell you, Amma. That is the problem of azeotrope. You heard of it? Azeotrope? What is the azeotrope? Azeotropes are actually constant boiling mixture.
Sir, in solutions.
Yeah, solutions. You have something called constant boiling mixture. So at 48% HBr, rest 52% water will stay as it is with it. Got it? No. So HBr, you will not get 48%. You will get maximum 48%. That means if you take 100 ml of HBr, actually 48 ml is only HBr. Rest is water. Water will be rest. So it depends upon weight percent or volume percent. I am not sure about that. But it's what, this is what you get. If it is weight percent, it is 48 weight percent. That means if you take 100 gram of HBr, suppose you claim that it is 100 gram of HBr, it's not actually 100 gram of HBr. What you get is only 48 grams of HBr and the rest is water. 52%, 52 grams will be water. That's what is the 48% HBr means. If they say it is weight percent or volume percent, it depends. I am not sure about the azeotrope what you get. They will normally say it's 48% HBr by volume as far as I know. So 48% HBr by volume means if you pour 100% HBr, what is actually taking part is 48 ml of that is only consumed for the reaction. The rest is water only. Okay. Now, if I want 100% HBr to be there within the solution, what I have to do, I will do by this way. So by the in-situ preparation, I can generate 100% HBr. Sir, why this problem? See, I have a beaker where I have to produce 200 grams of product, suppose. So this is a practical difficulty. I need to handle more amount of volume of HBr. Suppose I need 100 ml of HBr to make it react as per the stoichiometric calculation, how much I have to take? Actually, I need to take double the amount of HBr, what is actually needed for the reaction. Are you getting me? See, for example, yes, I'll tell you, okay, you may not be able to get. See, 50 ml is only useful, Amma. That is the thing, only useful.
Yes.
That is the thing, that is a funda. If you take 100 ml, 50 ml is only useful for you. Now, the thing is, that's what, simple calculation. Now, if it is like I need 100 ml for the reaction, what actually I need to take is 200 ml. I hope you got the idea. So that's the reason. That's the reason. Because I have to handle more amount of volume. That's why this in-situ preparation concept will come into the picture. Hope it is clear for you. Now let's move on. So that is what the in-situ preparation. Yeah. So you get all the other byproducts. You get KHSO4 and all this. And so we have. Let me write the reaction. C2H5OH plus KBr plus H2SO4. What we are going to get is, you remember this mixture is going to give me HBr only. So I get C2H5Br plus KHSO4 plus water. These are the things it is going to do. So this is the reaction. This is the required reaction. We have to eat a little bit. Now, how do you prepare iodoalkanes? Iodoalkanes, HI will be like 57% you have. Now you understood. If it is 57% means, if I take 100 ml of hydroiodic acid, actually the hydroacetic acid which is utilized is about 60% only. That is 57% only it is utilized. Okay, it doesn't matter. You will take C2H5OH plus HI. What is the product do you expect to come? C2H5I, that's it. Plus H2O. So this is how you can prepare iodoalkene. So this is iodone.
For this, we need not prepare.
Yeah, you can do it. In situ preparation is also there. We'll discuss it. Iodoethane. This is iodoethane. This is ethyl bromide. Or bromoethane. Or bromoethane, ethyl bromide or bromoethane. So we have an in situ preparation method. So in situ preparation method for HI also, it is there, that we'll discuss now. Have you noted?
Yes, sir. Okay. Yes, sir.
So the in situ preparation method for HI is like this: CH3. CH2OH plus HI. Oh, sorry. So what we do is KI, we'll add KI, but this time we'll add H3PO4 to it. Instead of H2SO4, you had to use H3PO4, that is phosphoric acid, and then you heat that. What you are going to get is CH3CH2I plus KH2PO4 plus H2O. So this is the reaction what you get. So here one proton is actually taking part in the reaction. So that's how you can think of. So it's like this: CH3CH2OH. And this mixture is going to give me, this mixture what it gives is HI plus KH2PO4. Okay, you can think like this. How the H3PO4 is dissociated? It is like this: H plus plus H2PO4 minus. Like this, it will dissociate. Now H plus is taken by I minus, and now H2PO4 is taken by K plus. Like this, you can take an exchange and then write the reaction very simply. Positive, negative, and negative, positive, just connect. Then the things will be all right.
No.
So these reactions, once noted, hello ma, noted, once noted, please let me know.
Noted, sir.
Okay ma, right. Now we have one last thing, that these reactions will give very good yields of the products. Now another important thing, what is that? Secondary and tertiary bromides and iodides. Bromides and iodides can't be made, can't be prepared, can't be prepared from their respective alcohols, from their respective alcohols by this in situ method. Method that means generation of the acid method we cannot use because they undergo as from this method as they undergo dehydration to give alkenes, as they undergo dehydration to give alkenes in presence of H2SO4, in presence of H2SO4. This is what you have to remember.
Okay, sir.
Now, the another point is that the order of reactivity of alcohols. Order of reactivity of alcohols with a given halo acid, with a given halo acid. That means like it can be like HCl, HBr, HA, any one of the thing is tertiary greater than secondary, greater than primary. Now this is one point. We have one last point. The order of reactivity of halogen acids with a given alcohol is HI greater than HBr, is greater than HCl. So this is the order of reactivity of acids for a given alcohol. For a given acid, this is the order of reactivity of alcohols. So with this point, we'll close Amma. So hopefully tomorrow, are you available at the same time, 8:30?
Yes, sir.
Okay, Ma. We'll have a class tomorrow also. I will continue the further in detail so that you will get all the points. Hopefully, you got all the points today. So,
yes, sir.
So with the detail, we'll do. Because we have enough amount of time. Don't worry. Okay. Take care. Bye. See you. Good night.